Yeah, so it's a quarter to 12 Moscow time. So let's proceed with our next talk. It's the last talk of the morning session. The speaker will be Michael Schmischke. And the topic of his talk is high-dimensional interpretable approximation of functions with low effective dimension. So yes, you can start with your talk, Michael.
Okay, thank you, Martin, and thanks to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to contribute a talk to this workshop. I want to speak about high-dimensional interpretable approximation of functions with low effective dimension. This is joint work with Daniel Potts, who's also here today. For the general setting, we consider high-dimensional functions defined over some domain D with spatial dimension small d mapping to the real or complex numbers. For non-periodic functions, we may imagine a domain like minus 1, 1, 0, 1, or r mapping to the real numbers. And for the periodic functions, we can imagine the torus as a domain, as codomain, the complex numbers. Our task is to find an approximation f tilde on f that is close to f in some sense, and we want to be able to interpret this approximation. So we want to tell which variables are important and how they interact with each other. This structural information we want to use in optimizing our approximation f tilde as well. This has a especially high relevance in applications where a lot of data is measured and you're asking which variables are more important and which things can be left out or don't have to be measured at all. For scenarios, I want to name two things. The first thing, black box approximation or active learning, where F is given as a black box where you can evaluate it at any point X in the domain. We have seen a lot of talks on this topic this week. We can, for example, use lattice rules with generating vectors of Korobov form, or we can use sparse grids and many other methods in this case. The second variant is scattered data approximation, where we're given a finite set of node x in the domain and we have some noisy evaluations y of the function. Both methods are highly relevant in applications. In the second part, you can imagine that you are just from some people from applications, you get a data matrix and they ask you to make some kind of predictions on it. Of course, if you want to prove relations, then you can also assume that the nodes are distributed according to some probability distribution. We will focus on the second part, the scattered data approximation in this talk. A quick overview. In the first part, I will introduce the classical analysis of variance or ANOVA decomposition. In the second part, I talk about group transformations and our approximation approach. And in the third part, I will show examples for synthetic and real data. Now, some necessary preliminaries. We have a function f over our domain, which is square integrable. I want to mention that we can also use weighted Lebesgue spaces here, but I just left the weight out for simplicity, but everything works just the same. Our function f can now be expanded in basis with the coefficient ckf times the basis functions, where phi k is our basis in L2, and the coefficients are the scalar product of f with phi k. The calligraphic D will denote our set of coordinate indices 1 to D, with D being the spatial dimension of the function. Our subsets of coordinate indices will always be denoted with bold small letters, and we take the complement always with regard to our set of coordinate indices. We will use those subsets to index stuff like for a vector. It would be very intuitive. You take just the entries of the vector where the coordinate index is contained in U, but we will also use this to index an operator and other things. The ANOVA decomposition itself has been used in many applications in infinite dimensional integration, in approximation, in the analysis of such methods. I collected a small list of important references. Some deal also with the more general multivariate decompositions. This is, of course, not an exhaustive list, but I tried my best to collect most important things for our talk and our application here. We define for every decomposition, we need a projection operator for such a subset of coordinate indices, which in our case will be the integral over f, where we integrate over the variables in the complement of our coordinate index set. You can show that this is the same as summing over all the frequencies that have zeros in the entries of the complement of our coordinate index set. Using this projection, we can define an ANOVA term by saying that it is the projection where we subtract the ANOVA terms where the set of coordinate indices is a proper subset of U. And again, you can show here that this is the same as summing over all the frequencies where the support of the frequency is exactly U. So the difference between the ANOVA terms and the projection in the sum would be that you don't allow zeros in KU for the ANOVA terms. Now the projection operator is of course the basis for every decomposition. So if you choose a different projection operator, this will lead to a different decomposition. For the classical ANOVA decomposition, this is exactly the correct projection operator. Then our ANOVA decomposition means that we can write F as the sum over all of its ANOVA terms. And this decomposition is unique in our case and orthogonal that such that the scalar product of Fu and Fv for u not equal to v is zero. A central question that I raised already on the first slide is how important is an ANOVA term Fu? For that, we need some language. First, I introduce the variance of a function, which is just what you imagine. So it's the L2 norm squared minus the zero Fourier coefficient or basis coefficient. For the ANOVA terms, the zero coefficient is zero. So we just have the L2 norm, and Parseval gives us this nice sum over the absolute values of the basis coefficients squared. Now it's easy to see that the variance of a function is the sum of the variance of the ANOVA terms without the empty set. If we want to know how important an ANOVA term is in regard to the function, we consider global sensitivity indices or Sober indices. This is just the quotient of the variance of the ANOVA term and the variance of the function. So a Sober index tells you how much of the variance one ANOVA term contributes to the variance of the function. Now we can ask the question, can we get importance of single variables from this sensitivity indices? And we answer that question with an attribute ranking. So for every variable x1 to xd, we can calculate the sum, where we sum up all the sensitivity indices where the coordinate index is contained in the subset of coordinate indices. And we norm this by the occurrence of the same order of ANOVA terms. This is itself not normed, but you can again norm this and then it will tell you exactly how much each variable contributes to the variance of the function. Now we of course have the curse of dimensionality, meaning for an increasing spatial dimension, we need an exponential amount of data for standard methods. We can also find this in the ANOVA decomposition since the number of ANOVA terms grows also exponentially in the dimension. We want to focus to circumvent the curse of dimensionality on functions with low dimensional structure or low dimensional interactions. For that, we introduce the concept of effective dimensions, or one notion of it is the superposition dimension. And for an accuracy delta, it is the smallest integer such that we can explain the variance of the function up to percentage given by delta with terms of up to order s. So now we can ask, how can smoothness be related to this concept, or how do certain kinds of smoothness influence our superposition dimension for a given accuracy? And then we can also ask, is this sensible for applications? Here we can argue with the sparsity of effects, or for example, the Pareto principle, where we say that most real-world system consists of small number of low-complexity interactions. If that would hold true, then the system would have a small superposition dimension. This would make sense. In order to relate the smoothness to the superposition dimension, we introduce the subway of type space with a weight function W, where we just collect all the L2 functions such that this weighted sum here is still finite. And using this Sobolev type space, we get a modified version of the superposition dimension from accuracy delta, where we replace the variance of the function with a supremum over the unit ball in our Sobolev type space. In the following, I will show you some results for a specific kind of smoothness, here isotropic and dominating mixed smoothness weights. So we have V alpha beta as this term here, where alpha regulates the isotropic smoothness and beta the dominating mixed smoothness. What you can show now is that if F is in a subwave type space of this kind with beta greater equal to zero and alpha greater minus beta, then this term that appeared in the modified superposition dimension can be bounded by 2 plus s to the minus 2 alpha times 2 to the minus 2 beta s plus 1. So for an s in between 0 and d. Now what you can see is that the right hand side is in this case not dependent on the spatial dimension of our domain. Now what can we answer with this? For example, if I have a isotropic smoothness fixed to alpha as 1, then I can ask how smooth does the function need to be in terms of dominating mixed smoothness such that the superposition dimension, the modified version, is bounded by 3. So I don't need more than 3-dimensional terms in order to explain, in this case, 99.9% of the variance of the function. The answer in this case would be that beta has to be about 1.41, just that you can imagine some numbers to the theorem. You can also make this a bit more complicated by introducing POD weights. We have this additional weight gamma for the supremum of K, for the support of K. And gamma is now has the order dependent part, big gamma, and the product of the small eta s. Now the theorem is exactly the same as before. We have big gamma non-increasing, then we get that we have the gamma s plus 1 squared in the front, and the product of the non-increasing rearrangement of the etas squared at the end. Now we want to incorporate this idea of the low-dimensional structure into our ANOVA decomposition. For that, we introduce a subset of ANOVA terms, which is a subset of the power set of D, such that for every term, we have all subsets also contained in U. If we have a superposition threshold, which means that we take up the terms with order up to ds, with this up to this threshold into account, this would be the set U ds, and this would fulfill this condition naturally. What would be the benefit of considering such a set U ds? The benefit is that the number of terms in the set grows only polynomially in D for a fixed ds instead of exponentially. So here we have lowered this in terms of complexity with the set of ANOVA terms U ds. If we want to truncate the ANOVA decomposition now, we have TUF is the sum over all ANOVA terms FU, where the subset of coordinate indices is contained in U. And for DS, we introduce the special symbol TDSF, where we take the terms up to an order of DS. In some sense, this is a bit related to spans, which we saw in the talk by Jan Wübler this week. I want to go on to talk about our idea of group transformations and our approximation approach. For group transformations, we consider functions P, some kind of polynomials, you could say, where the sum over a finite index set with coefficients fk hat and our functions phi k. Now you have seen sums like this in some talks this week. The special thing here is that we use grouped index sets. a grouped index set is a special index set where we have a disjoint union of index sets that belong to each group, and our groups are the ANOVA terms or the subsets of coordinate indices U. The set is now given by or determined by this parameter NU, which tells us how large for each group the index set is. We want to talk about the evaluation on a finite set of nodes of this function P. And this is the same as a matrix vector multiplication of such a matrix Fxi with our basis functions and our and the set of nodes in our index set and the coefficient vector F hat. You can also look at the adjoint problem, which is where you have coefficients given for each node and you want to have pk's for each frequency. This is just a multiplication with the transpose or joint matrix. Now, grouped transformations provide fast algorithms for multiplications with matrices of this type with F and F adjoint in both periodic and non-periodic setting. I will not go into much detail about the idea of grouped transformation. I will just present you the very basic idea behind it. So we have a grouped structure in our index set, and you can find a grouped structure then also in the matrix. Then this matrix, this one group transformation, decomposes into a lot of small transformations, which then can be realized by different methods, which I talk about in a second. And the thing that you also find is that all those transformations are independent in the sense that you can compute them all at once, both for the adjoint case and the normal multiplication. So this can be parallelized and basically they can all be computed at the same time. Some example functions that we can consider. For example, if we're in the space L2 minus 1, 1 to the D with the Chebyshev density, then we get the Chebyshev system as an orthonormal basis. For the periodic functions and the torus, we get, of course, the Fourier system. In 0, 1, 1 to the D, we can find this cosine basis. And if we have data over R with the standard normal distribution, we can find this system. Now the decomposed transformations are based on the non-equispaced fast Fourier transform for the periodic part and the non-equispaced fast cosine transform for the other parts. Cosine, the real system, and the Chebyshev system. Now, what is our scenario? We have a finite set of nodes X with M nodes in the domain, and we have possibly noisy evaluations Y. The function F is an unknown function, which at the point Xi gives us about the value of Yi. The assumption that we need to make is that F has a low superposition dimension, and we need a superposition threshold F such that F is about TDSF. The three general approximation steps would now be to first compute an approximation for F by taking only the ANOVA terms with order up to DS and the corresponding grouped index at I of UDS. The second step would be to perform a sensitivity analysis or compute the sober indices in this approximation in order to determine an active set of terms, which is a subset U of UDS, where we say that the terms in the complement of U are zero or at least small. The last step would be to compute an approximation for F with only this active set of terms U and the grouped index set I of U. Now, how do we compute an approximation for F given such a subset of ANOVA terms? We again have our grouped index sets as before, the size determined by the parameters NU, and we can now say that TUF is about this partial sum with respect to the index set I of U with our basis coefficient CKF and our basis phi k. Now, what's of course not known to us, because in general we have an unknown function, are the basis coefficients CKF. The only thing we have is the data X and Y. So we want to determine those basis coefficients via a least squares problem. We have a Y minus F times F hat, and we can add also regularization to it. I decided on L2 regularization. Here we also looked at different kinds, but I don't want to go into detail about that. The matrix is again our matrix with the phi kx, and our solution vector f sol hat will be fk hat in each entry. Okay, now at the top, you can see again our least squares system. And what we do now is we apply the iterative LSQR solver with group transformations. So what we don't need is we don't need the matrix F exactly in our memory, which in most problems would also be far too big for that. We just give the group transformations as a method for multiplication with F and F star, which is already enough. Now, depending on the distribution of the nodes in the space with the Chebyshev functions, we would have Chebyshev distributed nodes, we would have uniformly distributed nodes in 0, 1, and for the Fourier system, and we would have normally distributed nodes in the case of the transformed system. And depending on this, we can say that the matrix has full rank and that F transpose F is a diagonal matrix with a high probability. Can, for example, find this in the paper by Kemmerer, Ulrich, and Volkmer from 2019. Now, if we have solved this problem, we can say that TOF is about this approximate partial sum, and we have replaced the exact coefficients with our approximate coefficients from the least squares problem. In the last part, I will talk a bit about applications for our method. I will start with the non-periodic Friedmann 1 function. As you can see, this is a function defined over 0, 1 to dimension 10. And we have a term, a function that is only depending on the first 5 variables. So that would be the challenge that the first challenge for our method to detect that the variables x6 to x10 don't play any role. The second challenge would be to see that analytically, we have only the linear terms x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, and this one two-dimensional interaction x1, x2. As a training set, we use a set of nodes of 200 nodes in 0, 1, uniformly distributed, and the evaluations will be with Gaussian noise with zero mean and unit variance. In order to test our method, our approximation, we have a test set X test of 1000 nodes with the same noisy evaluations. The superposition dimension for an arbitrary high accuracy would be 1, so we choose the superposition threshold, that would be 2, so we choose the superposition threshold, also DS equal to 2. In order to measure the quality of our approximation, we will take the mean square error, so we have the sum where we have the noisy function evaluations on the test set minus our approximation obtained with the 200 training nodes. U star will then be the active set of terms which we detect in the following. Our first approximation step is now to take the only the two-dimensional terms of the Friedmann function, the 10-dimensional Friedmann function, and look at an attribute ranking R. You can see here we have an approximation with very small frequency parameters. So we take only 3 in the one-dimensional case and 1 in the two-dimensional case. You always have to subtract these numbers by 1. As regularization parameter for L2, we have lambda is equal to 3 and superposition threshold is 2. Then we get that the first 5 variables are, of course, far more important than variables x6 to x10. They are very close to 0. So what you can do is we throw them out. Our new active set will now be UR, which are the two-dimensional interactions of all the subsets of 1 to 5. The second thing that we want to find out is which terms are active or in which we can throw away in the next step. And here you can see this is an approximation where we increased also both parameters now. So we take 5 frequencies for the one-dimensional terms and 3 for the two-dimensional terms. And our regularization parameter is 1. Then you can see that this active set, which I have in orange here, is exactly the one we would find analytically. So we have the 5 one-dimensional terms and the 1 two-dimensional term. Our mean square error for this method would now be that we have 100 times randomly generated training and test sets, and we have taken the mean over that. And this would yield a mean square error of 1.43 compared to a support vector machine, which is the next best method for this function that we could find, with 4.36. Of course, this is taken in the exact same setting, meaning that we have this 200 nodes and this 1,000 test nodes and the same amount of noise. In the end, I want to talk about some applications from real data. The 4 data sets you can see on the top here are taken from the UCI database. We have the first 2 sets, ENC and ENH, that are 8-dimensional with 768 data points, and they are about the energy efficiency of houses. They tell you the cooling and the heating load, and our data set contains data from some model houses. The airfoil self-noise data set is about airfoil, which is used in planes and some space applications. It's 5-dimensional with 1,500 nodes. And the Eileron's data set is 40-dimensional with about 14,000 nodes. And this is about the control of an F-16 airplane. Now, for result comparison, we have looked at different methods and what they achieved, the best we could find in the literature. The first 2, the ENCH data set, they had a root mean square error of 1.79 for a gradient boosting machine, so a machine learning method, and 0.48 for a random forest. We could achieve 1.49 with our method and 0.44 for the ENH data set. So the airfoil self-noise data set was considered by the sparse random features method, which is quite new by Rachel Ward and her co-authors. They achieved a relative error of about 2.77%, which we could get to 1.61%. The last data set, Eileron's, the output was normalized to 0.1 here. And there we get that the root mean square error was about 0.046 for a local learning regularization neural network, and about 0.0449 for our method. Now, for the data, we always performed a min-max normalization, so the data is in 0.1, and we used the cosine system that I introduced earlier. So what you can take away from this maybe is that with this model-based approach, we can also beat some machine learning methods on those benchmark data sets. Now, here are some references where you can find the stuff I talked about, and I want to thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Michael, for your very nice talk. Are there any questions from the audience?
Yeah, maybe I have one. Could you go back to the examples with the plane and this 1,500 data points and stuff like that? So this sounds cool. Can you say something more about that? So what does it mean to have a data point? Do they really make an experiment, or what kind of data are you using there?
So there's this UCI machine learning database, and there are basically, this stuff is very old, from end of the last century. And you can find data sets there where people already have used in some with some benchmark methods. And that's what we compared it to. So basically, there are very, very different things. For example, the housing stuff with nice applications. And here, yeah, people from different fields use those data sets. Also very current, the sparse random features is just from the start of this year. So also very current. And the nice thing is that we can also say, that's something that I left out, is which of the variables are important. So for example, I can tell you that for the ailerons, which controls are the most important for where the plane goes, or for the housing data sets, which attributes of the house contribute mostly to the heating or cooling load.
So again, maybe I got it wrong. So you can tell me this because of your simulation, or that's part of the data that you can, so is it information you already have? Or?
So they give you a big matrix of data, like, so this would be had 8 columns and 768 rows. And there would be one thing you have to predict, in this case, a vector of the cooling load with just values in it. And now we split this data set with the 768 points into some for the generation of our model, for our approximation step, and some for testing this and computing those errors. And what we do is always we make those splits 100 times in random. So I split this 100 times in random so that I get a result that fits all the data, basically. And this is always the mean of that experiment.
So, but the real solution is not known to this.
That's the problem. Yeah, you can only test on the data that's given to you. So there's no exact solution known in this case. That's of course different if you take a function like the Friedmann function, then you know exactly where you want to go, and you can also measure the error and the basis coefficients because you can compute them analytically.
Sure. Thanks. Cool stuff.
Okay. Are there more questions? Maybe I also have one question concerning this Friedmann function. It's the first time that I hear from this function. Where does it come from? Or is it a very artificial function?
This is a relatively old function. There are more than, I call the Friedmann one function because there are of course more than, there's of course more than one function. And it's very old and it has always been used in regression problems as some kind of a benchmark method. So you find this in a lot of papers as a example. If your method works well on this function, then people accept that the method works well somewhere else. So there are more functions with more with other challenges. But I chose this one because it's important to check if like that only 5 dimensions play a role in this 10-dimensional function.
Okay, thank you. Any more questions? Okay, so then we thank you again, Michael, for your nice talk.
Thanks.
Now there is a lunch break till 3 p.m. Moscow time, I think, and then the afternoon session will start.
Okay, thank you to all the speakers.